all for coming to our last CASCI talk of the semester. We are very excited to have Dr. Oluwatoyin Ayanlade, who is visiting us from the Obafemi Awolowo University in Nigeria. She actually gave a talk at CASCI last semester talking about this project and what she was going to do. So we are very excited to hear what she did do with the project. And so without further ado, we'll turn over to you.
Hello. Thank you so much, Priya. Good morning, everyone. And I want to thank those people that were here during my first presentation. Thanks for coming again. And those people that were not here too. Thank you also for coming. My topic, research topic, is on applications of information. And let me stand up so applications of information and communications technology innovations for educational and gender empowerment in selected rural areas in southwestern Nigeria. This will be my outline. Background to the study. We all know what ICT is. It's just the use of devices to manage and deliver information in form of audio or video or data. So ICT information now involves using technology in new ways to improve alignment between technology initiatives and a particular group. What innovation is just saying is using the same thing to meet your purpose. It may be in a different way. People might have been using that thing before, but using it in a special way to meet your purpose, to achieve a particular goal. So far, this ICT innovation will be used to empower individuals. We need to know who an empowered individual is. An individual that is empowered must be able to have a sense of self-confidence and self-worth to be able to exercise control over decisions that affect his or her life. That is, when you are empowered, you'll be able to talk. When you are empowered, you'll be able to make decisions. People will not influence you, but you'll be able to know what is right for your life, you'll be able to know what is right for your future, and be able to do that. So, gender empowerment using ICT innovations would be very, very useful for underserved population like people in the rural areas, because it will remove the barriers of time, distance, access, mobility that deter education. You know, these people, they are underprivileged. So using ICT innovation for them, we're able to give them opportunities to achieve what other people in the town are achieving. Then it promotes economic gender empowerment by providing skills training in higher value jobs. We'll see that later as we continue. This study was conducted in southwestern Nigeria. Southwestern is a geopolitical zone in Nigeria. We have six geopolitical zones. It's one of the zones, and it has six states. We have the Oyo State, Osun State, Ekiti State, Lagos State, Ogun State, and Ondo State. And according to 2016 Nigerian National Census, this southwestern zone has 32.5 million population out of the 153.5 million population of Nigeria. Statement of the problem. Adolescent pregnancies is called Nigeria number one killer of girls because of the rate at which it's killing Nigerian girls. And it's very common in Nigeria. Like in the rural areas, one out of three girls we have this teenage pregnancy. But in the urban areas, one out of 10. So that you know that it's very common in rural areas. And it causes dropout of school. Immediately a girl is pregnant, she will be advised to withdraw. Whether, even if she's the best student in the class, she will be advised to withdraw. So it causes dropout of school, and it's attributed to poverty and little or no education. Because these people, because of this dropout, definitely there will be little or no education. So it contributes to it. It contributes to little or no education. Then, one of the reasons why it's the number one killer of girls is that it's people have unsafe abortions, girls have unsafe abortions from me. Because of the shame it will cause, because of the stigma, they'll be forced to go and have abortions. And when they have abortions, they will go to people maybe that will do it cheaply for them. They will not mind their lives. And that's why it causes unsafe abortions and complications during childbirth. Those people that have even decided to keep the pregnancies, when they want to deliver, because of the young age, some complications, and it will result to death. You can see here from the picture, people, because of the shame, they cover their faces. They say 90% of, that's this from World Population Day 2013, that says that 90% of 100 girls in developing countries, so it's not only Nigeria, it's in general, it's a global problem in developing countries. Significance of the study: empowering girls educationally and economically will reduce teenage pregnancies. This is because when you empower them educationally, they will be busy. They will be able to face their studies, and they will be able to earn income, higher income later in life. Because these people, some of the causes of this teenage pregnancy is idleness. One of the causes is idleness, because when they don't have something to do, they just say, let me go and do that my boyfriend, and it will result to, and because they are not empowered, they cannot make decisions for their lives, they'll be forced to do that. So there's a need to bring back hope to the affected generations so they can return to school. What of these people that have made mistakes? Is that the end of life? So they need to be empowered so that even, because they are still young, though they are giving birth to children, but they are still young, age is still on their side. So we need to bring back hope to them so that they'll be able to reach their full potential. Research goal, so it's to investigate information technology innovation options and deployment strategies that can educationally and economically empower the disadvantaged girls and women in the selected rural areas in southwestern Nigeria. It's not just about to identify the options, there has to be strategies, because you know, these rural areas have peculiarities. They have something that we just need to consider before these ICT options can work there. So we have to have deployment strategies for these ICT options to be in use. The research questions. The first one, what are the existing ICT options in place in the selected rural areas in southwestern Nigeria? Which ICT options could be proposed for gender empowerment in the selected rural areas? What are the factors influencing the use of the selected ICT options in the study area? Then, based on the previous findings, second one and the third one, how can the selected ICT options be used to empower the girls and women in the study area? Then, how should the proposed ICT options be deployed in the rural areas? Scope of the study. This study was conducted in southwestern Nigeria, only southwestern Nigeria. Did not consider other zones to have in-depth study and analysis, because we wanted to concentrate on the zones so that we would have in-depth study and analysis. Then it emphasized educational and economic gender empowerment. There are other types of empowerment, but this study only focused on educational and economic gender empowerment. All other types of empowerment, like social empowerment, political empowerment, were not taken into consideration. The study area again. This study, as I've said, alone was conducted in southwestern Nigeria. That's a map of southwest Nigeria. We have the six states. These are the geopolitical zones. We have this north central, northeastern, northwestern, southeastern, south, and southwestern. And southwestern is the study area. That's the map of Africa, and Nigeria is in the east boundary of West Africa. Then that's the map of Nigeria there. Then Nigeria, the map, the southwest is the one that is highlighted. And the map of the southwest now is enlarged here. We have the six states, the Oyo, Ekiti, Osun, Ondo, Ogun, and Lagos. And the locations there that you can see, they are the places that went for the study. Three rural areas in each state. So for example, in Oyo, went to Alasan, Elikuru, and Ijefun. So these are the three locations, just like the rest too. So three rural areas in each state. Method, population and sampling now. Geopolitical zone was purposely selected, as I said earlier, to have in-depth study and in-depth analysis of the area. Then three rural areas in each state of the zone were also purposely sampled, because wanted to make sure that all the states were covered. So that was why we made sure that every state, we went to every state. So three rural areas in each state of the zone were studied purposively. Then the rural areas were selected based on their sizes, because we did not go to the places that have that very big, because the more big these rural areas are, let me say, the more opportunities they have. I wanted to go to places that would be able to use this ICT for them because they have less opportunities. Then population and sampling, continuation of population and sampling. Rural areas, according to ANELE 2012, even called rural areas the places that are neglected by the government. Why did this say so? Because they said that they don't have good schools, so they can't have good education. Some don't have lights. Those people that have electricity, is very poor. So lack of proper roads for vehicles, they don't have good roads. Then lack of portable water supply. You can see from the pictures, it's only that I can't see, I don't have a pointer. I would have shown that house, that's one of the houses there. The one that is looking like the one that will collapse tomorrow. You can see up there. That's the house. You can see how bad the houses are, they are living there. And the houses there actually collapse. So that you know the type of structure they have there. Look at this one too. That's the water I wanted to drink. This one is even better because most times they drink streams. And those streams, they go to the stream to take their bath. They will bath inside the stream and they will still drink out of the stream. So, but this one is like, well, was not covered. And they are taking the water from me. Then you can see the type of roads they have. They don't have good roads. So those are parts or some of what they are facing there. Research design. Primary data was used for this study, and we used two methods to collect the primary data. We used questionnaire and interviews. The quantitative data were from questionnaire, where qualitative data were from the interviews. The questionnaire has two sections. The first section was asking about the demographics, while the second one was asking about information technology options, innovation options, for gender empowerment. Then the qualitative for the interviews, the interview was semi-structured, and as I've said, I had three girls, 18 girls altogether, were taken from all the six states, three girls per state, and they were randomly interviewed based on their availability. The questionnaire was in two languages, English and Yoruba. Some can still understand English to a certain extent, but some cannot. So those people that can understand English and they ask for the English questionnaire were different, and some Yoruba. Actually, it's not for the purpose of some to not even fill. It was the data collectors that were asking them, helping them to fill, so that to have reliability of data. So 30 girls, 10 girls from each rural area were randomly selected from each state based on their availability. Thus, we had a total of 180 girls for the questionnaire. And 6 women were randomly selected also from each rural area. For the women, what we did was we made sure that all the ages were covered. So first, 6 women per rural area, we made sure that 2 were from between 21 and 40 years, 2 from between 41 and 60 years, and 2 that are above 60 years, so that we know what had happened during their time, because things change. So we wanted to know, okay, this one, at least you are married some years back, things, maybe that time, it was not like that. There's another thing that is happening now. That was why we varied the ages like that. Thus, we had a total of 180 girls and 180 women for the questionnaire. And semi-structured interviews too was also in English or Yoruba, depending on the language the person wanted. So you will be able to understand very well. For reliability and validity of data, for our data to be reliable, we pre-tested the questionnaire questions and the interview questions before they were administered. 3 copies of each were pre-tested in a particular rural area, 2 rural areas that were not included in the study. Then expert opinion too. 2 specialists looked at the questions before they were administered to make sure that the questions were okay before they were administered. The quantitative data from questionnaire was coded and analyzed in SPSS, while the qualitative data was analyzed in MVV. Results and discussion now. Before we go to the research questions, we need to know the characteristics of our participants, the people that took part in the study. These were just extracted from the characteristics, the highest educational qualifications. Girls and women, because we had two sets of questionnaire. So for the girls is in one column, women in the other column, for the other side. So I put the ones that are the highest in red so that people to see. For girls, we can see that 60, this is in percentages. You can see that for girls, the most people were secondary school dropouts. That is, they managed to finish their primary schools, but they had to stop due to one reason or the other that we know it. Then, for women, their percentage that they were primary school dropouts. You know that. That time, that means it's getting better. You know, I varied the ages. So that means things are getting better now because that means the number, because those times, because you varied the ages of the women, those times, most of them were primary school dropouts. They would not even finish primary school before they got pregnant. But now, we have higher number, for present girls now, we have higher number of people that managed to finish primary school, but they are secondary school dropout. Therefore, income source for girls, most of them, the higher percentage says they don't have nothing, that they have nothing. They depend on people. They are girls, so it's normal. But for women, their percentage says they have work to do. They just have to work. They need to find work to do. Because these women, they have children, irrespective of their age. So they just need to find a way of meeting their needs. Then for the people that are pregnant, I put that one in red, so 20% of them are pregnant. That is 20 out of 100. You can see that these girls are still becoming pregnant. If 20% can be pregnant, so that means there's still a problem that we need to solve. Therefore, for the women now, we now ask, because it's, the questions are similar. Their ages are their first pregnancy. You know, they are married now. Most of them said, you can see 59.3, that's the highest, below 20 years. That is the present women too. They got married before they were 20. That is, and what married that we are saying, not that they go to church, want to get married or go to mosque or go do ceremony. Pregnancy is the cause of the marriage. That is, they got pregnant before the age of 20. So why pregnancy happened now? Most of them, even for both of them, for girls and women, they said it's gift and cash. That's the problem now. Because they are being enticed. And because of the high rate of poverty there, because they need something. That's why they are, if I want to give you something, I need to collect something. And it's give and take. So, and because they could not make the decisions, remember, they are not empowered. And for this one too, so who caters for most needs, for their needs, mostly? The girls did not even disclose. Most of them did not disclose. We don't know the reason. It might be because they have illegal source. Maybe they don't want us to know the places they were getting, the places that was meeting most of their needs. Maybe they were afraid, I don't know. Most of them did not disclose the places that was meeting most of their needs. For girls, for women, they said safe. Well, this result surprised me because most of them did not say husband. They said self, that is to say, their needs, they just had to struggle to meet their needs. They could not rely on their husbands. Then, from polygamous home, most girls, even the women, both of them mostly said yes. That means they are from polygamous, and it's a factor. That means how would the parent meet the needs when there are many wives many children, many wives, for instance, for their father? The number of fathers' wives, most of them, even the girls and the women, said between 2 and 4. The father will not marry one wife. The father that is struggling to meet the needs of the children will still not have one wife. So that means poverty will is really increasing, and this the needs will not be met. The number of mothers, husbands. In Nigeria, our culture, in our culture, women marry mostly one husband. That's what the girls say, no, do not disclose mostly. Don't know why. Maybe some people that know that maybe their mothers are having, maybe they are, they could be having concubines or something, but to be legal. So this one too, they did not disclose for their mother, but for women, they said that their mother have one husband. The number of siblings for girls said that they have, that is between 5 and 7. So you can imagine a father having more than one wife, and having between 5 and 7 children. Then the woman said the number of siblings they have is even more than 7. That's the highest. That they even have more than 7 siblings. So that you know that they have many children there. That's why the fact that they marry early, they still have many children. And that's why they will not be able to meet the needs. And the children will need to look for sources, maybe from their boyfriends to get something. So considerations for the research objectives is that although we are proposing ICT options, but we need to make sure that we base our decisions on the existing ICTs. I will explain what I mean. The ones they have, those are the ones that we work on, because they are used to those ones first before we introduce new ones. Because, like for instance, if I know how to use this phone very well, for instance, and you want to empower me, think of what you can use this phone to do for me, because I'm used to it. Unlike if you go and bring something that is very complicated, I say I should come and use it, you want to use it to empower me. So we first base our decisions on the ICT options in use for them before we introduce new ones. Then the goal is to make sure that those people that have not started education commence the education. That's for educational empowerment. And those ones that have stopped, to make sure that they continue. What that is saying is that although we will empower economically, but those people that still have interest in education, that is the paramount thing. Because according to Adeleke 2016, it says that if they are empowered educationally, then they can hire more for their future. So educational empowerment is the priority. But those people that have lost interest in education, or that they cannot continue because of their age, then we can now introduce economic empowerment. Then, because if you introduce economic empowerment to people girls that are supposed to be in school, let me tell you, they will stop school because the money, they say, I have money. Why am I going to school again? So I have this, so I don't need school. It happens. They just say they will not have interest in school again. So for economic empowerment, as I said earlier, we still do on the existing ones. Then from this table, we can see that for girls, most of them, their percentage is not doing anything. But for women, they are mostly traders. The traders, what they are selling could be in forms of many things. It could be the produce from their farm. Then it could be from conventional works. They produce palm oil. They produce what we call gari. They could make this and sell in the market. But you just know that they trade. It's what they are now trading depends on what they are doing. So girls must be empowered educationally, have brighter future. This is the palm oil we just talked about. When they make this palm oil, they can now go to the market and sell. You can see the way they are doing it. You can see the way they are doing it. It's just a manual way of doing the palm oil. This is the farm. They do the farm. And this is the trading, the type how they trade. You can see here, they will put what they want to sell inside wheelbarrow. You can see, they will put this inside the wheelbarrow and be pushing. I'll be pushing, especially if what they are selling is heavy, that they don't want to put on their head, so they put it in the wheelbarrow and be pushing. That one too is another way that they sell, they'll put it on the head and be saying, come and buy, oh, they'll be telling people, come and buy, oh, it's another way. Or they go to the market, that's another way. They go to the market, they put what they are selling down, and people will be coming to buy. So, now, research question one. What are the existing ICT options in place in the study area? We asked about all these ICT options. We wanted to know the ones they know, that they can choose, not that they just hear about it, that they can choose, that if I give you this now, can you use it? So the ones that they can use very well, we gave them all this. And you can see the highest for girls and women. For girls, radio was the highest, even for women. For television, followed by television for both of them, and mobile phone. So I was now wondering why radio would be the highest. And I discovered that. You see, these people, they don't have electricity all the time. For radio, they can put battery. They can put battery inside it, and they'll be able to listen to news. They'll be able to, at least they will know what is going on around them. So at, every day, you see them, at night, they put it on the table and they will stay outside. They'll be outside. They just put a chair and table. They will be relaxing, put the radio there to be listening. Even if there's no light, they'll be able to use the radio. That's the radio. Because we have another mini of radio. That's the radio. And that's the TV. You can see the TV. The TV they mostly have is not color TV. It's black and white because that's what they can afford. It's black and white TV. It's not color TV that will just show the graphics in color. Then that's mobile phone. So radio first, then television, then mobile phone, followed by the rest. Then those are just the ones they are using presently. Now, which ICT options could be proposed now for gender empowerment in the study area? Because we know what they already have. This is what they already have. Because from the previous slide, you could see that they had everything, but only that the percentages were not much. But they still, some have, I mean, some know they know how to use the internet. But they may not. They have the internet through their mobile phones anyway, because the mobile service provider provides internet. That's the only way. Those people that have the internet, that's the way. Not Wi-Fi, as here. Then some have heard about projector. Some have CD player, maybe few, and some have an interactive CD too. But all these ones that they at least that some or that many or some have, those are the ones that are already in place. The radio, television, mobile phones, computer, internet, projector, and CD player. Now, these are the ones we are now proposing. Based on what they have, we want to see how we can use what they have to empower them. See, these are the ones they have. They have mobile phones. From the interviews and from the questionnaire, what they only use their mobile phone just to call, to receive call, and to make calls. That's all. They don't know any other thing to use phone for. So we now want to see that for educational empowerment. Now, do you know that all these books, you can have electronic books that you can be drawing, because we know that they cannot afford to buy books. We know that they cannot afford to buy big notes, don't have much, but we can buy, from here, I can buy electronic books to and send to them from here. They're like, well, I know I sent one to my boy that's using Kindle. They don't need to be here. They don't need to be where I am. They can have access to electronic books. So, instead of them complaining that they don't have books, they're able to, at least they take their phones to everywhere they go, so they can have access to the books everywhere they go to. Their notes too, they don't need to buy, add, whatever they want to write something, they can use notes on the phone. Voice recorder. For educational empowerment, there's one, I thought I put it, one literature like that I said, mobile phones features best taught when you are teaching languages. An English language will be taught, will first be taught to all of them. Even if they decide that they don't want to go to school again, we want to teach every one of them, both girls and women, English language. That's what we want to do. That everyone, if you think that, is this part more I want to be doing? When you know how to speak English language, you'll be able to have more customers. So we want to teach everybody English language, and all these tools will be very, very useful in teaching all of them English language. Because when they have mobile dictionary, mobile translator, those people that only understand Yoruba, using their phones, they can see what is this in English, and they'll be able to learn. So each and every one of them want to empower them, because by making sure that even if they decide that I don't have interest in school, I have interest in English language. It's Nigeria's official language. And if you can speak in English, you'll be able to have more customers. There's nobody you'll not be able to talk to. You don't need an interpreter before you talk to another person. Because this Yoruba language is a local language that is for that place. That is to say, if we are trying that, we are trying to so that you're able to have more customers if you want to be empowered economically. But if you cannot speak English, if the customer is coming from another place and you cannot speak the general language, how will you communicate with the person? So mobile dictionary and translator, we have calendar. If you have an appointment at the person, a customer, you have to go and this is for educational empowerment. If you have an assignment to submit, I don't want to forget, you can put it in calendar. Then search software too, you'll be able to use this so that if you want to know more about a particular thing, or you want to know more about something, you can use it, and so on. Then, University of Success talked about Boss of Broadcasts. B-O-B. We talk about all these later anyway. This is just to identify them. It's just a list to identify them. We talk about them later. Then social media, e.g. WhatsApp, Facebook, and so on. They can use it on the phone. At least they have phones. Then there are some specific application software that you can download. That, like the exam time, when the exam is approaching, it's just like it's a customized software for a particular class or grade that they are in. I'll be able to know some questions. If they'll be able to know if they are prepared very well for the exam. This is just a list that we'll explain them one by one later. Then we start question two, which ICT options could be proposed for gender empowerment in the study area? It's still the same research question, but this one is for economic empowerment now. The same thing that they have. But mobile phone features now, we have double search. Okay, fine. Then the way these ones will be used, the same thing, but they'll be used separately. They'll be used the same ICT options, but the way they are used will be different, which I will explain later. Like this e-commerce now. E-commerce, they can have more customers, they can be able to buy and sell online, they can have more customers through online. That is when they are empowered economically. We'll talk about all this later one by one. So all these are the proposed ones too. Then research question three. What are the factors influencing the use of the selected ICT options in the study area? We have so many factors because these factors are necessary because if you want to propose something to them, but there is a barrier and you don't want to talk about the barrier and you want this thing to be successful and you don't want to talk about what will not make it to be a success. So we have to talk about all these things. We have electricity, it's a barrier. Some don't have electricity at all. Some have, but the electricity is very, very erratic. Then lack of skills or training, family support. Even if I want to do this, will my family support me? Then live exposure. The background they have, like that, the one what they have been exposed to since the time they were young is a factor. Then language limitation. Cost of acquisition, high internet connectivity, because to use mobile phones for internet in Nigeria is very expensive. It's very expensive. So, but it's a service that if you can afford it, it's there. Then lack of awareness, lack of time and others. The ones that is very high is cost of acquisition, which is high internet connectivity, 99.1%. You can see that the blue ones are for girls, while the red ones are for women. Both girls and women, they both agree that high internet connectivity is a factor. The cost, high internet connectivity cost, there's still cost there. High internet connectivity is a factor that will make the ICT, that will not make the ICT options to work. Because most of these things depend on internet. That's why they say it's a factor. Then, and so on like that. So all these factors, one by one, have to be taken into consideration. The consideration will now form my recommendations later. Then results and discussion. Now, how can the selected ICT options be used to empower the girls and women? Now, this is where we are now. That's how we explain what when the ICT options, how they will be used. Like, you know, WhatsApp is for both economic empowerment and educational empowerment. For the two of them, it's used for communication. If you know these girls, even if you talk to them and say, see, you just need to to make good decisions for your life. You thought they say, ah, I'll make decisions. When they leave, when you leave, there another person that wants to confuse them. Say, well, don't mind what they're saying. You enjoy your life, be pregnant. I will take care of you. The boy will just lie to them like that. But if there's a communication between you and the girl, and you and the kind of mentor, the girl can say, oh, the boy said he will take care of me. You can quickly say, don't mind him. He's just deceiving you. But there's no way of communicating between the mentor and the girl. When the boy brainwashes, that's the end. But if there's a kind of communication, if there's a mentor, it could be the person that's introducing the ICT. It could be some girls in the city. Maybe the girl that's a counselor. But if there's a communication, be able to tell the person that, see, you can make it. Don't let him lie to you. When he marries you now, he will go and marry another wife. You know, the person can and say, okay, I will try. Because these girls, they are just being deceived. So if they have a mentor and there's a good communication using WhatsApp, that will be the first thing. Because you need to inspire them first. You need to encourage them first before they can take the decision that, okay, I want to go to school. I want to be empowered. So a kind of mentoring, an information exchange. The girl that is in fourth grade, I'm just using that grade as an example because that's what we use here, that is in fourth grade in town, and the person that's in fourth grade in village, if there's a kind of information exchange, can say, I have an assignment. I don't know how to do it. The person can advise because there's a kind of information exchange. So the WhatsApp can be used for educational empowerment like that. Even there's an information exchange. Mind you, if you want to empower these people educationally, it has to be distance learning. Because for resources that they don't have there, if it's online, if it's distance learning, they can tap resources from other places. Where they can just be in the village using the internet and they'll be able to learn. So that's for communication. Then radio, like there can be programs in the radio that will teach out a particular topic. Because neither of them listens to radio, they can say this tomorrow, when they finish your program today, they will tell them what they will do tomorrow. This is what we've done today. Tomorrow we'll teach you how to solve quadratic equations. And lots of broadcasts that the University of Sussex was talking about is used to record programs. So that if you are not there at that time, your mommy or your daddy can record for you or your friend and you'll be able to play it later. So that radio is for group teaching, can teach a particular topic, a particular subject, and they'll be able to listen to it at any time they want to listen to it. So this information exchange will let them overcome isolation. The isolation is what I just talked about. Now when they are alone, they will consider, this boy is telling me is try to, maybe I should consider him. And because there's no information exchange, because they are isolated, because there's no way of communicating, that's how they will just agree. But that's why communication is very, very important, because it will help them to boost self-confidence. When they are confused, they have somebody to talk to. They have a way of talking. So I don't know whether we have found ourselves in such a situation before that we are confused, don't know what to do. But because we have talked, we have found a way to maybe call somebody or we send a text message, the person replied. That thing helped us to make decisions and make right decisions. So that's why communication is very, very important. It's used both to empower them economically and educationally. Economically, distance education, I've talked about e-learning, that when they have the internet, they can be able to connect. Then using their mobile phones, they can use those to take notes, text messages too. Text messages doesn't require internet. That's just the beauty of it. So if they are in the same country, they can just send SMS to the person. Their voice recorder, mobile dictionary, and so on. So group teaching, as I've explained before, radio and television, we can programs can be organized. Then so that people to teach them. The good thing about that radio and television is that it will be in their own language, in Yoruba. And that's the language they understand most. So it will be able to reach them. They will be able to understand what the person is saying. Then, if they have TV already, we can use projector or big screen. If you want to teach them in the village, they are used to big screen, to screen before, so we can talk about big screen or projector, see the player and so on. Then, we have game software. We can even install game software in there. You know, there are some games now that is teaching you something, and you think you are playing, but you are really learning. So we can put it on their phone. Then e-commerce, need internet for connection. Then they can help them to connect to customers that will come and supply goods to them, and the people they will sell goods to. Then weather forecast for farmers, because the way the climate is changing, they need to know when to plant and so on. So they need the internet, like weather software on their phone. They access to resources. There's a software that is downloadable, Hello Tractor. It will connect them when they need tractor. Instead of having tractor that will just stay idle when they don't need it, it's not every time they need it. They will just connect to the person that will bring tractor to them, just like Uber. So it's called Hello Tractor. Then computer work processing, they can have that. Maybe they have computer or phone that will be able to organize their work. They will be able to do calculations. They will be able to document price list, income they have, the expenditure, and so on. Then it's also a source of employment to them, because like recharge card sellers, the recharge cards, they are things that you put on your phone that will give you more airtime. So some they can sell for those people in the villages to create a kind of employment for them. Then telecenter, although you tell the talk about telecenter, for those people that can't afford internet, there can be like a room, like a place like this, so that you just have few computers that have internet. So they can come, they just pay. You just pay the person, they can come and use the computer and the internet. Those people that don't use computer, don't have computer or internet or even phone, they can come in and use it and just pay. They pay per hour. So they just use it maybe for 1 hour, 30 minutes, and they just pay and they go just to do what they want to do. So telecenter operators too is just another source of employment. So for research question 5, how should the proposed ICT options be deployed? We know that we want to introduce ICT. But you can see factors, there's a barrier. It's like factors influencing the use of the ICT on the way. It's either you mitigate the factors, you remove the factors, or you leave the factors as they are. You can't do anything about it. Just if you leave it, we have more teen pregnancies. But if you say, what can we do? Let's do something about these factors. Like those people that said there's no electricity, there are other sources of power supply. We have solar, we have enough sun in Nigeria. Let's find a way to mitigate these factors. It will bring this our head, and also it will make the ICT use to be sustainable. It's not something they will use for 1 year and leave. Because you have find solutions, permanent solutions to the problems of the factors, then it will make the ICT use to be sustainable. Then this will now lead to the educational empowerment and economic empowerment that have goals. And we now have reduction of teen pregnancies. Unlike the other one that is more teen pregnancies. Conclusions. We have seen from the study that the most common ICT options in the study area are radio, television, and mobile phones. Then the most influential factor of the use of ICT in the study area relates to cost, which is not affordable to the rural residents. Then the most cost of pregnancy among the girls is gifts or cash. Then most girls drop out after primary school education. Then the participants only use mobile phones to make and receive calls. A mobile phone alone is a powerful tool for educational and economic empowerment because of its so many features. Recommendations, they have to be trained. All these new features we have introduced, we need to train them before the introduction and during the introduction and implementation. Then the problem of erratic or no electricity supply can be solved by alternative use of solar system. The telecenter stations can be set up, as I've explained earlier. The English language, being official, Nigeria official language, must be taught in the rural villages to all girls and women. Then the Nigerian federal government, through the local government, should fix the bad rules. Like if you are increasing the market, they'll be supplying they will have more suppliers and they will have more customers. But if there's no good road, it will be a problem. There has to be subsidy necessary for the acquisition of all the tools needed. The future research question will not be how can we use ICT in terms of mechanization to enhance traditional or conventional works they have. I want to thank American Association for University Women, AUW, for funding this research. I want to thank University of Maryland and for their support and the enablement and the environment they have given unto me to achieve this. Then Obafemi Awolowo University, African Institute for Science Policy and Innovation Nigeria, for all the support. I'm very grateful. These are some references. Thank you.
We have about 15 minutes for questions. So feel free to jump. I have one question. I think what was the difference between girls and women? First of all,
girls.
In your sample, I should specify. Yes. I guess my question is, the research focuses a lot on the issue of teen pregnancy, but from what I remember, the women in your sample were all 21 or over, right?
Yeah.
So did you actually talk to teens, or sort of what's the connection between talking to women over 21, but then how does that connect to the issue of teen pregnancy?
Okay, thank you very much. The girls, they are the people that are not married, that they don't have pregnancy yet.
Okay.
But the women are the people that have already had a pregnancy below, before they were 20.
So, sorry, the phone is ringing for some reason. And I don't know what to do. Has this happened before?
It's
from Denver. Okay.
Hopefully it doesn't ring again. Sorry about that.
Session.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
Okay. The girls are the people that are not married. They don't have the pregnancy yet. They are less than 20 years, and they are not. They don't have the pregnancy yet. So this study is how to avoid them being pregnant by empowering them. But the women, they had the pregnancy before they were 20. Now, how can we empower them economically if they cannot continue their education? The women were considered because economic empowerment was involved. If it's only educational empowerment, they have talked about girls. But because economic empowerment was introduced, and mostly we want the girls to go to school. So educational empowerment will relate mostly to girls. For women, they might have lost interest because they have stayed at home for long. They might have lost interest in education. But how can we still give these people voices when something to say is by empowering them economically? So, and because this is a gender study, we also why we included women also was that we discovered that these women too have to be empowered if we want teenage pregnancy to reduce. Because if these people can't meet the needs of these girls, if the women cannot meet the needs of the girls, these girls will still be pregnant. So we need to empower the women, their mothers. We need to empower them so that they'll be able to meet the needs of these girls. So that all the efforts of our empowering them will not be in vain. So we need to empower their mothers so that economically, so that they'll be able to meet at least most of the needs of the girls. So that the girls will be able to have psychological stability to be able to go to school. So, women are above 20 years, they are like their mothers, and girls are less than 20 years.
Can you talk a little bit, Dwayne, about the cell phone access? Because I think a lot of the intervention that you suggested requires data, and you had mentioned that most of them right now just can call and just make phone calls, right? How expensive it is to get a phone with data, and how is that going to be affecting some of the suggestions that you're providing?
Okay. We have smartphones.
Mm-hmm.
You can see smartphones in their hands. That was why I put the pictures of phone. So that you know that the phone, they will just say, it's just for me to receive call. I don't need any of that. It's just for me to receive call to make calls. So they will not go for smartphones. And smartphones, you need smartphones to do most of these things. That's why I put in my recommendation that if these things can be subsidized for them, if you really want to empower them, you can just take a few smartphones there, subsidize it for them. The same amount they will buy these cheap phones so that they'll be able to use, because some mobile phones they have don't even use WhatsApp. So they'll be able to use a phone that have all these features.
It was so interesting that the radio was such a prominent one that was like everyone had. And it's because radio is less interactive than some of the other ones that you talked about. And I could see why the interactive ones, there's so much opportunity. But I'm curious about if you could think of ones with the radio that could
Okay, you mean for communication?
Yeah, or is there a way to make the radio somehow a little more attractive?
Yeah,
like,
okay, thank you. Like for when there's program, like when they're, you know, they use radio to listen to news and other programs, and I talked about good teaching, that radio you can use it to teach.
Mm-hmm.
So what they do during that program is that they will put a phone number on the screen. I don't know whether they do it yet. They put a phone number on the screen to call if they have any question, so that if they call that number, the person doing the program will pick
right.
the call.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah.
Yeah.
So that leverages also the calling, which people are doing already.
Yeah. So they can communicate with the person doing the program, although the person doing the program will not be able to call them,
right.
but they can call the person doing the program. Likewise,
yeah.
television can do the same.
Also, I'd like to add, like, the radio and the television, I mean, it could be, like, a good, like, environment because it can be shared by many people.
Mm-hmm.
Unlike the smartphone, which is, like, only
okay.
used by one person.
Okay.
So I think, if it's deployed, I think it would be more beneficial because, like, if you have a family, if you have many girls or women, you
okay.
can, like, teach them a lot. I mean,
yeah, thank you.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. That's just, like group teaching. That's why I said group teaching, because not teaching of one person. All the girls in the village can target that time and say, we want to listen to this program at 7 o'clock.
Mm-hmm.
And they'll be able to teach them at once.
Yeah. So what's
next? Publications, after publications, then future research, because we need to publish these findings. And if there's funding to do it, we can really implement it, because it's just theoretical. We can really go to those villages and give them what they need as in implementing this research.
I guess I was asking more sort of not just publications, but how are you going to get this across, right? Because there's a lot of, how do you share this back with your community? This particular community, because they are not the people who will be reading publications now, right?
Thank you. When we wanted to conduct collect the data, they were asking this question. They were asking this question that what are you going to do for us when you collect this data?
Yes.
So I was trying to tell them that if the government or if you have any funding, we're able to come here, we're able to come back here. Use the findings, our findings, to know how we can empower you. So, they are very ready for them to be empowered. They are very ready. But implementation will need funding. It's not something one can do. So,
the team premise is also a public health issue, right? And then, are you aware of any public health initiatives that can complement this ICT solution? Talk about like implementation, right?
Yeah, okay. I can look that up for any and the organization that form public health issues. Okay, thank you for the information.
I think many other developing countries that I've familiar there is some intervention that are done by local help with public health issues, not specifically for loss and pregnancies, but is there something that could be done with community centers and also libraries if they are up for it? I don't really know, so I'm asking.
All these things you are mentioning, is the government that is doing it for them? So in Nigeria, there are many things that we don't have access to. That's supposed to be done by the government, but we don't have access to. So if you need a library, you use a library of your school, which is only that the only students of the school can have access to. So all these girls, there's no community library that these girls can just go if they don't belong to a particular school. So there's no public library, let me put it that way. Even in urban, where you see public libraries is maybe capital of the country, you know, but when we're talking about nearby urban centers, you won't see public libraries there. And it's a problem to them, it's a problem for them because they won't be able to have access to books. That's why I was talking about electronic books for them. The electronic books, that's just the best for them, because even if you say that you want to give them, buy books for them, they won't be able to take that. Maybe the book is heavy or something, they won't be able to take many books wherever they go. But if it's electronic, they will be able to have access anytime, anywhere.
So I just
want to
say that there's another, maybe a few more minutes. Toyin, you did this research in the fellowship was
for a year.
But it took you a while to get IRB approval because you know this is done with people who don't have literacy and can't read the IRB. And how long that process took? For
they just approved in January, in December, at the end of December.
So that means how many months did it take
to do it?
No, to get IRB approval.
Like five months.
Mm-hmm. But she had two RAs helping her to collect the data, which was fortunate, right? So it actually she did the collection, data collection and analysis within 5 months.
Wow.
So it was pretty intense. Yeah. Talking about educational empowerment and gender empowerment, right? And on top of that, she just had a baby 6 weeks ago. So So I just want all of us to give another round of applause.
Thank you so much. Thank you. And I want to thank her too for her support.
Thank you so much.
One thing that I was thinking of, and this is also my own bias because I'm much more of a qualitative researcher, but I was thinking interested in terms of sort of future directions. It seems like this is really ripe for some other type of methods, like whether it's action research or sort of ethnographic work where you're sort of in the community and working, especially if the people there themselves are very excited about, you know, what's going to come of this, how will this help us? I'm thinking, I don't know if you've thought about how any other types of research methods where you could be more directly working with the community. I mean, you'd probably have to focus on only one or two. You wouldn't have the breadth, but I feel like that could produce some really interesting insights around what types of interventions, because you covered such a broad swath of different types of interventions. Being able to think about what would work in this particular community. I don't know if you've thought about that, going in that direction.
Yes,
at all.
Yes, I can do that. Thank you for that. Mm-hmm. So that's at least, for instance, working in Nigeria, we have federal government, state government, and local government. Mm-hmm. Like if local government, as in this, the local government, these areas, if they can just work with the staff, so that they will know what is happening and be able to fund. But I pray Nigeria gets to that. Because research is not the priority. It's only people in the academics that you know that you need to find out. Even if you give them the findings, if you cannot fund yourself, they will just put it on the table and they will not do anything. It's a problem. So I will see. I will see what I can do. Because I'm
grabbing.
Thank you.
There's a lot of factors, but great.
All right. Well, if there aren't any other questions, then we will give you
one more round of applause.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yeah. Thanks for coming. Thank you.